Hey, welcome back to the Ping Pong Flick Show. My name is Chris Wong. I've got a few DC updates for you and a major big one for Ray Fisher. The first one up is probably going to be a little update on the Batman. Then we got a little, maybe the actual beginning of David Ayer's Suicide Squad, at least an explanation of it anyway. Also, a DC fandom part two is coming out. So the trailer obviously had to come out as well. And then, of course, big news about Ray Fisher versus Warner Bros. Before I get into that, of course, I have to once again thank you to the members of the Ping Pong Flick Show. Here they are right here. Once again, thank you to all my members of Ping Pong Flick Show. I hope you enjoy the exclusive access videos in the folder, exclusive access folder. Be sure to stay tuned. This Sunday, we are definitely going to get another video for you to show exclusively to you. All right, guys. Well, now on to the show. Catman is back on. Oh, wait. Production remains paused as cast and crew quarantine, right? This is a funny thing that happened this morning. Production on the Batman continues to be on pause after Robert Pattinson tested positive for COVID-19 this week, according to a source with knowledge of the situation. Variety previously reported that shooting on the film had resumed without Pattinson, citing a story in the Daily Mail. However, studio insiders denied that report. Crew members are still doing construction work on sets and props at Warner Brothers Studios in Leeds, Dens, United Kingdom, but people on the film team who were in contact with Pattinson are quarantining. The production is still doing contact tracing. It is unlikely that shooting will recommence until the roughly 2-week quarantine period ends, which I kind of said in my last video in terms of Robert Pattinson probably having to do that 2-week isolation, right? And now Warner Bros. Didn't really actually confirm that Robert Pattinson is the one with COVID, but sources close to the production has reported that to Variety and the Hollywood Reporter. So that's probably true. But you know, it's bad for publicity, in fact, to that, right? So the Batman is not back on, as previously reported this morning, for like an hour, and then now it's back, it's closed again. But like I said, it does sound like they're still trying to work things out in terms of making props and things in the meantime, while Robert Pattinson is currently in isolation with that. All right, the next thing that I want to talk about is a film that has already been done, but there is a version of it that we really want to see. And this is something you guys have been asking about lately, so I'm finally happy to tell you there is a small update on that. Not about the release, but about the beginning scenes of his Suicide Squad. What I'm talking about? I'm talking about David Ayer's Suicide Squad. This is a tweet that went out today. David Ayer had put out, the first scene in June is June Moon discovering and releasing Enchantress in a jungle location. Next scene is an extended assault on Arkham by Joker's crew. Then he electrocutes Harley. There was more to the club and an argument between Harley Quinn and Joker in his car. Now, we know that is definitely different from what we saw in the movie theaters. We actually do start off with June Moon discovering and releasing Enchantress, which is very much very similar to the actual novelization of the book. Then next is the extended assault on Arkham. We pretty much go through that Harley Quinn and Joker arc right up to the Batman chase, all in the beginning of this movie, which I think would actually flow better. And I'm really intrigued to see that instead of that, that MTV style back and forth that actually happened during the actual movie. So I'm really looking forward to David Ayer's Suicide Squad, and I hope Warner Media finally puts it out right on HBO Max. And here's hoping for them to release the Ayer cut of that. Next up is in regards to HBO Max, and this is actually kind of exciting for people who don't have HBO Max right now. We could probably save you a few bucks now. HBO Max is now $11.99 a month, right? Because before it was $14.99 a month. Now, because they're putting out that Save for 12 promotion once again, you can have it for $11.99 a month, right? And despite this is kind of probably a way to try to get more people to subscribe. But I understand that, you know, this is still not available on Roku and Amazon Fire devices, although Ann Sarnoff had clarified that they are definitely trying to get that working on those said devices. Like for even for myself, the only way I can watch it on my big screen is to plop it in and turn on my PS4. So hopefully we get that going. It'll be a lot easier getting out of Roku and Amazon Fire devices. All right, next up, in terms of Warner Media putting out more materials and more things for fans, DC Fandom. DC Fandom Part 2, in fact, is coming out September 12th. And they decided to release a trailer today. In terms of that, it doesn't give you much more than showing you that there's a lot more behind the scenes looks at this. There's a lot more things going on at this DC Fandom. September 12th, you do see them using the app this time. So that's the schedule, right? So if you look at the schedule, there's not much more in terms of reveals, right? There, it doesn't look like that there are going to actually be like exclusive reveals of new movies or anything like that. Things that we kind of hoped that they would do, but it's looking a lot more like behind the scenes videos, even videos that appeared in past movies in the second DVD or the second Blu-ray disc, rather, right? And also more things about the TV shows and things like that. But so essentially, it may not be a second Hall of Heroes, if you will, but it does show you that it's much more interactive this time around by letting you just go to these little islands, just like the DC Fandom islands that they had there. Right on your phone, you can click on any of these islands and go directly, even rewatching some of the Hall of Heroes, to go directly to the panel that you want to look at and be able to access it that way. So that is quite interesting, and that is certainly different than the Hall of Heroes that we had a few weeks ago. So, but that's the DC Fandom Part 2. I certainly, even though it's not that big of a deal in terms of, you know, exclusive movies and things, I don't think, I'm still looking forward to seeing what they have in store for us over on September 12th. That's DC Fandom. Now, Warner Media has gone through some things in terms of DC and DC Fandom, but there are also some not so good things, but hopefully could lead to positive things for the future of Hollywood and for Warner Brothers. What am I talking about? I'm talking about Ray Fisher versus Warner Brothers. He put out a huge tweet today talking about a certain individual at Warner Brothers, and here it is. So you can better understand how deep this goes. After speaking out about Justice League, I received a phone call from the president of DC Films, wherein he attempted to throw Joss Whedon and John Berg under the bus in hopes that I would relent on Jeff Johns. I will not. Accountability over entertainment. Now, important to note that he doesn't actually say Walter Hamada here, but he does say president of DC Films, which is currently Walter Hamada at Warner Brothers. And this is him in a Variety 500 talking about how he came in, is also was pretty much the team behind The Conjuring, one of all those New Line Cinema horror movies, Shazam, The Batman with Robert Pattinson, and James Gunn's The Suicide Squad. Walter Hamada, right? What's interesting about this tweet is that, for all intents and purposes, what Ray Fisher is essentially trying to say is that the president of DC Films has, almost in Ray Fisher's words, undermining the investigation by trying to talk Ray Fisher out of accusing Jeff Johns. He's literally trying to say that, look, we'll get rid of Joss Whedon and John Berg, but please don't touch Jeff Johns. This is essentially the president of DC Films trying to say this. Very disappointing. I am very disappointed in the president of DC Films. But maybe we should have saw this coming. how he was more in the Geoff Johns camp rather than the new camp right now, right? And the new camp loves the Joker, right? Joker brought them $1 billion at a real mere fee. But that profit was split three ways because they didn't have confidence in it. And who didn't have confidence in it? Who didn't get it? Well, apparently that was Walter Hamada. This is a comicbook.com article where Todd Phillips, the director of Joker, talks a little bit about Walter Hamada. When the regime changed on the Warner Brothers side, the regime also changed on the DC side. They put a guy in charge at DC, Walter Hamada, who had been running a small horror label at New Line. So he didn't have much muscle to stop it. And I'm not saying he would have, but he didn't get it. And because on paper, it's crazy. He just stepped into this new job and we just made Shazam and Wonder Woman. We're doing okay. Do we really want to mess with this formula? And they really did. And thankfully did. And they let Todd Phillips make a movie that essentially made $1 billion plus multiple Oscar awards. Yeah, it really turned things around. But it did really make AT&T Warner Media relook at Warner Brothers at the decisions that they've been doing and ultimately looked at it and said, you know what? Let's release the Snyder Cut. So In the past, I have done positive videos for Walter Hamada on how he was trying to get Zack Snyder's Justice League. He's probably in the Zack Snyder camp and everything like that. But now it seems that may not be the case, and he was actually in the Geoff Johns camp after all. So, but this doesn't end here. Literally tonight, in a few hours ago, Warner Brothers actually released a statement on the wrap of all trades, right? Now, Warner Brothers put out a full statement right here. I'm going to read it to you. In July, Ray Fisher's representatives asked DC Films president Walter Hamada to talk to Mr. Fisher about his concerns during the production of Justice League. The two had previously spoken when Mr. Hamada asked him to reprise his role as Cyborg in Warner Brothers' upcoming Flash movie, together with other members of the Justice League. In their July conversation, Mr. Fisher recounted his disagreements he'd had with the film's creative team regarding his portrayal of Cyborg, and complained that his suggested script revisions were not adopted. Mr. Hamada explained that creative differences are a normal part of the production process and that a film's writer or director ultimately has to be in charge of these matters. Notably, Mr. Hamada also told Mr. Fisher that he would elevate his concerns to WarnerMedia so they could conduct an investigation. At no time did Mr. Hamada ever throw anyone under the bus, as Mr. Fisher has falsely claimed, or render any judgments about the Justice League production, in which Mr. Hamada had no involvement, since filming occurred before Mr. Hamada was elevated to his current position. While Mr. Fisher never alleged any actionable misconduct against him, Warner Media nonetheless initiated an investigation into the concerns he'd raised about his character's portrayal. Still not satisfied, Mr. Fisher insisted that Warner Media hire an independent third-party investigator. This investigator has attempted multiple times to meet with Mr. Fisher to discuss his concerns, but to date, Mr. Fisher has declined to speak to the investigator. Warner Brothers remains committed to accountability and to the well-being of every cast and crew member on each of its productions. It also remains committed to investigating any specific and credible alleged allegation of misconduct, which thus far Mr. Fisher has failed to provide. Now, that is a statement from Warner Brothers and not from Warner Media. So that fact, you do have to understand that there are two separate entities. Warner Media owns Warner Brothers, a party that they acquired after buying out Time Warner. So that's something that should be noted at this moment in time. Warner Media, AT&T, was responsible for releasing the Snyder Cut, a cut that Warner Brothers tried to hide and never get it released. So be aware of that. But this is an interesting statement and release in which they're pretty much trying to, in a way, to me, in my eyes, demean Ray Fisher's character by saying he's only here over creative differences. in which is kind of different from what Ray Fisher has been tweeting out about their abuse of power, misconduct, you know, things like actually abusive actions over on set, things that have really nothing to do with just creative differences. I'm sure there's that too, but other things that could be legally not, you know, good for these three individuals and maybe even others. So it's interesting that Ray Fisher put that out today in terms of DC Films president Walter Amada. And mere just hours ago, on a very late night in California, that Warner Brothers decided to put this out before the three-day weekend. It's very interesting. And it does seem like this is not going away. This is going to keep going. And it's going to be intriguing from here on out, especially how it all started with all Walter, Ray Fisher's tweets. But the last tweet before this was about Ray Fisher talking about the investigation. After 5 weeks of interviews with various cast and crew, WarnerMedia has officially launched an independent third-party investigation to get to the heart of the toxic and abusive work environment created during Justice League reshoots. This is a massive step forward. I believe this investigation will show that Geoff Johns, Joss Whedon, John Berg, and others grossly abused their power during the uncertainty of AT&T's merger with Time Warner. Thank you, WarnerMedia and AT&T, for making strides to ensure a safer workplace for all. And this was on August 20th, 2020. Now, a few of my colleagues have said that it's possible that he didn't want to talk to investigators because they weren't willing to look into Geoff Johns per Walter Hamada's suggestions, possibly. In which, does that mean Walter Hamada tried to get in the way of investigations? It's possible. But we'll have to wait and find out. This is not going away. This, I think, is going to turn into something much bigger and something much more serious involving parties on Ray Fisher and Warner Brothers and Warner Media, as Warner Media will probably try to get either ahead of this or try to get to the bottom of this. And which I hope it's the latter, because I think Ray Fisher, who have said countless times, this is not about him getting a role. This is not about him getting into the business even more. He's willing to throw that all away. Accountability over entertainment. And that is something that should be respected, that this man is willing to go the distance and he's not able to be bought at this point. So that could be a very dangerous thing for people like Joss Whedon, John Berg, and Geoff Johns, and possibly others as well. So I want to see what happens next. I think there should be or could be a response as soon as this weekend from either Ray Fisher's party or Warner Media. But I think there's going to be a response to this, and I don't know if this will end up in court. If it does get to court, this will be pretty bad publicity for Warner Brothers. So I'm thinking they're probably going to try to avoid it because it could really blow this whole Justice League situation, all the behind the scenes, wide open. And I think they're going to try to keep that under wraps. So looking forward to seeing what happens next. And yes, I definitely 100% I stand with Ray Fisher, especially for all the things that I've heard myself about the behind the scenes on Justice League. But to leave on a lighter note, not to make light of Ray Fisher versus Warner Brothers situation, I want to take you back to that actual release, that statement from Warner Brothers, disregarding, but not disregarding a situation, but just kind of highlighting an actual thing about the Flash movie. And I don't know if I know we're all emotional about this, but I do see something there that is worth mentioning. Now, I'm going to put it up. The Flash will have other members of Justice League. Yeah, if you look at the statement once again at this part, Cyborg in Wonder role as Cyborg in Warner Brothers' upcoming Flash movie together with other members of the Justice League. So this actually confirms the report from before, and I had a video on it, that Cyborg was indeed going to be in the upcoming Flash movie. Now, we did have that, that character slate or actor sheet, that thing that Grace Randolph had put out, you know, she had a screenshot of it, and it did say Ray Fisher to reprise his role as Cyborg, which is just what Deborah Snyder had suggested back in 2016, that he should be in the Flash movie. Well, now it's confirmed that just recently they did have plans for Cyborg to be in the upcoming Flash movie, but also together with other members of the Justice League. Who could that be? It can't just be Batman, right? Other members of the Justice League? I'm starting to think that they did, in fact, have a certain plan to make it more Flashpointy than Flash. Maybe? Is that still in the works? Are we going to get to see Wonder Woman? Aquaman? Superman? Shazam? I don't know. But it is intriguing to see that little statement then. Although to me personally, that statement there is actually Warner Brothers just trying to say that, look, we threw Ray Fisher a bone and he's not taking it. But hey, accountability over entertainment, like Ray Fisher says, and I think he's going to give it his all, and this is going to go the distance. So waiting to see what happens with this. Like I said, as soon as this weekend, I think we'll probably maybe hear more news from Ray Fisher's camp or Warner Media. All right, guys. Well, thank you so much for subscribing. Thank you so much for watching. Like I said, if you love this pretty much a daily movie news update content and upcoming DC shows and games, which I'm also going to cover, please click the like, subscribe, and ring that notification bell. Keep this hot dog light on, and I'll see you next time.